Hi, my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology, and on this channel, we talk about all things data visualization. Now, when you're first starting out in data visualization, one of the challenging things that you might struggle with is identifying what is a good visualization and a bad visualization. To some degree, there's some aesthetic preference that goes into that, but you might want to know what is the science behind an effective visualization. So today, I'm going to talk about one principle that will help you understand if your visualization is effective or not, and can help you evaluate other people's visualizations as well. The principle is expressiveness. So let's jump in. Okay, so this term expressiveness is a tool that we can use to understand when a visualization is effectively doing what it should be doing. The definition of effectiveness is a set of facts is expressible in a visual language if the sentence, i.e. the visualization, in the language expresses all of the facts in the set of data and only the facts in the set of data. So let's unpack what that means part by part. First thing we'll talk about is expresses all of the facts of the data set and only the facts. And I'll use some examples to illustrate how this can help you understand if a visualization is effective or not. Okay, let's start here with this single horizon dot plot. You might see a visualization like this, and if it's presented to you, you might draw some conclusions. So let's take a moment and walk through some of the conclusions that you might draw from this visualization here. First of all, we are looking at dots that are color-coded by group. You might look at group A and say, okay, there's one dot for group A, there's three for group B and C, okay? You might think that group A has lower values, whatever the values are in this case, and there's not much more you can draw from this visualization. The tricky part is that you don't know how this visualization was created, and oftentimes graphing software have these defaults that allow certain unfortunate functions or situations to happen with the data. For example, there is what's called occlusion going on here. Now, occlusion is when you have a data point that is in front of another data point, and it makes it so you cannot see it. Oftentimes, graphing software has that as a default, and you have to do some modifications to remove this occlusion. In the first example here, the dots were fully occluding the other. When you make the visualization, you might be aware that that's the case because you would know that there's more data that is not being represented. But when you're viewing the visualization, you would have no idea, okay? So this is essentially an example of how a visualization is not expressing all of the facts in the data set. Just by the way it is visually depicted, it is removing important facts in the data. That's not to say it's not all there. The data is all there. It's not like someone has removed it. It's just not visually apparent to the viewer. So in this way, this visualization is not expressive. It is not expressing all of the facts in the data set. And we would consider this to be ineffective. Let's look at another example. Here we have two confidence intervals. You might be presented with this information report. These are 95% confidence intervals, and this is usually all you're presented with. Now, if we're looking at this and trying to make some conclusions from it, we might say these two data sets look pretty similar. Maybe they're based on the same data or just highly, highly similar data. If we drew that conclusion, we would be very wrong. The top one is based on a normal distribution, and the bottom one is generated from a bimodal distribution. The underlying data set is very, very different, but if you look at just the confidence intervals, it is hiding or masking over that important information. So these can hide important features of the data. So again, that would mean that it is not expressing all of the facts in the visualization. It is omitting or masking or hiding this information. And I just want to be very clear that it's not as if the visualization designer did something quote unquote wrong. They didn't remove the data. They didn't, you know, modify the data. They just chose the wrong visualization that is not expressive of this particular data set. Okay, let's move on to the second part of our definition, which is expressing only the facts in the data set. Not only do you have to show all of the relationships in the data set, but you must show only the relationships in the data set. Let's see an example. Okay, let's just take a moment here and look at this visualization on the right. It's showing car nationality in 1979. I want you to try to answer what is wrong with this visualization. I want you to pause the video and try to figure out what is wrong with this visualization. Okay, what do you think? You probably have seen several things that are wrong with this visualization. The one that I want to point out to you has to do with the y-axis. Notice that we have US, Japan, Germany, France, and Sweden on the y-axis, and we have bars representing if the car nationality was from one of those particular countries. Now, again, that is not inherently wrong in the sense that the designer didn't manipulate or do something nefarious with the data, but he chose bars to represent categorically different information. When we see bars, we're thinking about quantitative values. We're thinking about a range, 1 to 10 to 20, et cetera, and it's showing this span of information. We're not thinking about categories per se. So what I'm seeing here is that bars suggest ordering of the y-axis, indicating that somehow the US is lower than Japan, Germany, France, and Sweden. And as you get a bigger bar, you get Sweden. So somehow it's implying that there's more something associated with these Swedish cars. That's not the case at all. These just happen to be Swedish car companies, okay? So it is implying information that is not there at all, just by the choice to use bars and not another visualization technique. We also have the length is interpreted as a quantitative value. We tend to think about positional information. That's where you're placing something along the X and Y. When you have kind of a span, we think about information adding up. And that has to do a little bit with psychology, but also the way that we learn to read visualizations and the conventions that we learn to interpret these charts. We often see bar charts showing quantitative information. This visualization here violates some of our expectations, and people might come to the wrong conclusion if they're viewing this very quickly and making a snap decision with this information. So what we have going on here is that it's representing all of the facts of the data, but not only the facts. It's adding on a little bit of extra information that is not in the data set at all. And that is where the problem is. Here's another way you could visualize a similar data set. This is taking the information that was previously shown and breaking it into a visual encoding that suggests categories, showing independent categories here with color and ordering. And maybe you can think of other cool ways to visualize this data set. Comment down below with your favorite suggestions on the best ways to visualize this particular data. Okay, let's look at one more example. And this is with the notorious 3D pie chart. Now, I've talked about 3D pie charts in the past, and if you're looking online about visualizations, you will see that a lot of people are against a 3D pie chart, and you might get that you shouldn't use them, but it isn't fully clear why you shouldn't use them. So I wanted to show you an example as it relates to this expressiveness principle. I'm actually going to manipulate this. So I made these two pie charts in Keynote, and this is our data set here. When you're looking at it from a top-down version, not in 3D, you can see that this blue portion of the pie is the largest, okay? It's very clear. I also added the numbers there, so you can just see it, okay? Here is the same data set, and I'm going to manipulate it in 3D. Now, when we have it here like this, is it fully clear in the same way that it is up here that the blue portion of the pie represents the largest portion? No. It's not. And that's because this green section is closer to us. And as things become closer to you in your field of view, they're bigger actually on your retina as the image hits your retina. So that's what's going on here. Now, why does this relate to expressiveness? Well, part of what is going on here is this 3D version of the pie chart is expressing information that is not in the data set. It is conveying to me that this gray section of the pie represents a larger proportion, and it doesn't. That is not in the data set whatsoever. These are all exactly the same. What I'm getting at is that one of the main reasons that 3D pie charts are a problem is that they violate the expressiveness principle in the sense that they're expressing information that is not in the data set. And that is really what you should be thinking about when you're selecting visualization techniques, is does the technique represent all of the information in the dataset and only the information in the dataset? Before I move past pie charts, if you're interested to learn a little bit more about how we actually read pie charts, there's some really great videos from my friend Robert Cassara on this exact topic. He researches how people understand and use pie charts, so definitely take a look at those. Now, the expressiveness principle is really just one tool in our toolkit for evaluating visualizations, and it is very nice because it gives us a minimum, a base standard, that if the visualization violates the expressiveness principle, it's bad. That's not to say that anything that meets that bar is good. It's to say that at a minimum, visualizations need to express all of the information in the dataset and only the information in the dataset. And if they don't do those two things, then they're bad. Now, beyond that, there's lots of other things that make a visualization really effective that we'll talk about in great detail in future videos. Things like making the visualization memorable or trustworthy, or allowing people to interact with the visualization and gain insights. Those are all really powerful things that will make your visualizations increasingly more effective, but they need to meet the base standard of expressiveness. I hope this video was helpful. I find that this concept can be a little tricky for people who are just starting out, in particular because the term expressiveness isn't fully intuitive how it relates to visualizations. Also, there is another term that I'm going to talk about in the next video that is very similar, and people get these two confused. So feel free to refer back to this video if you forget what expressiveness is, and use it when you are doing evaluations of your own visualizations to determine if yours are expressive as possible. Thank you for watching this video. Stay tuned for my next video, where I will talk about how to understand which marks and encodings are most effective to use, which you can also use as an evaluation method as well. Take care.